Hello, everybody, and welcome back. It is Monday, November 15th, 2021, and you are listening to episode 124 of the Can I Say Something podcast. I'm your host and a recluse with a juicy caboose, Damien. Joining me today is my number one boy,
DJ Ouija.
Today on the show, we'll be discussing with spoilers for everything, always the best show on television today, right now, Succession. Reviews of some of the most anticipated films of the year of our Lord 2021, and the Wheel of Time book series, right into the show, bicycle@gmail.com, bicycle on Twitter, subscribe on iTunes, Stitcher, Google Play, Spotify, rate and review it on the old Apple Podcast. Tell a friend, family member, or stranger. What's up, Deon? How you doing?
Hey, man, I'm good. How are you?
Pretty good, pretty good.
So I'm your little autumn boy, huh?
I was the little autumn boy. I was listening back to podcasts as I do. I did the, what was it? During the autumn, I was like, little autumn boy Damien. Wintertime, I was little winter boy. I don't think I was ever a little summer boy or a little spring boy, but I think I would have if I thought of it then.
Hey, there's always next year, bud.
Exactly, exactly. So, a lot to talk about, but first and foremost, free Britney. Britney's free. Bow, 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 bow. She's free from her conservatorship, which apparently is a thing where if your guardian, if your legal guardian convinces a court that you're out of your mind crazy, then they will allow that person to basically control your life. And it's very, very hard to get out of that sort of situation. But apparently she did. So good up to her. Good for you, Miss Spears.
Yeah, it was nice for the fans to come back around and defend her. Because honestly, she, you know, it's like you said, she probably couldn't have done that otherwise.
Yeah.
You know, so.
Yeah, no.
To go from laughing when she was denting cars with umbrellas and shaving her head to to that guy saying, right? It was a guy, right? Saying, leave Britney alone.
Sure.
And we're all beaming on that.
Right.
And then, then we get the full 180 where the fans were like, holy shit. Yeah, we were assholes. Somebody should do something.
He was right. He was correct the whole time.
Didn't that start like with a TikTok? Like the whole motion got set because she was like, maybe not TikToks, but posting clips or something about like she was like burning down her house or something, or like someone said, wear yellow if you're in trouble. I don't know. I feel like there's some kind of legend behind how this ball started rolling.
So apparently in June 24th, she gave testimony saying that, you know, she's been, has no control over her own life. I'm trying to find the quote, exactly what the quote was. But she gave testimony this year saying like she is of sound mind and body, and she doesn't need this, this what would you call it? Guardian thing, but it's more than a guardianship. It's more, it's like a
hostage situation.
Yeah, it's very much that. But she's apparently free to do what she wants now, which is crazy. I mean, it's good for her. Good for her.
Yeah, that was crazy too, because she's got two kids and everything. So it's like, were the kids hostage by proxy? Like, confusing, odd relationship. Yeah, but I'm glad it's all worked out for her.
Yeah, and
ready for our next album to drop.
Yeah, Britney is free, but unfortunately, Steve Bannon is not free. Womp womp. Steve Bannon got didn't get arrested. Feels bad, man. Feels bad, but not bad. It's like sorry, not sorry. let me see here. Steve Bannon.
What, he's not your personal hero.
Not really. I mean, I did have up until today. He was my avatar for Venmo, but I took that off today just because his face reminded me of it. Yeah, so that's great.
True.
Yes, I remember you looking at that picture when you sent me the money last year for when I won the Oscar pool party, and you were like, "Who is this? Who is this man?" It's like, "Yep, triple shirt Steve over there."
Hilarious.
Steve Bannon, a longtime ally to former President Trump, was indicted Friday on two counts of contempt of Congress after he defied a congressional subpoena from the House committee investigating the insurrection at the U.S. Capitol. Justice Department Ted Bannon, 67, which that's a rough 67 looking guy there, was indicted on one count for refusing to appear for deposition and the other for refusing to provide documents in response to the committee subpoena. It wasn't immediately clear when he would be due in court. So there you go. You know, it's always shit like that. It's always like, he's going to be subpoenaed. Oh, no. Okay, we're going to, he's indicted. What does that mean? Well, if he comes on his own volition, then maybe we'll arrest him. But we're not going to actually do anything if he doesn't want to come. So, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, so I mean.
Always.
What's a charge of contempt of Congress come with? Like 30 days? In prison, maybe? Maybe a fine?
Yeah. 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 You know, it's always those fucking things of like, we did something. The Democrats can be like, we did something. No. No, you didn't. You didn't. You tried to. A for effort, Democrats, but not, still nothing actually happened. Yeah. They made a good
Yeah, they got to be more like the NFL right now. They got the Henry Ruggs. You hear about him?
No.
So, yeah, this football player, basically, he was flying down it was a populated street, but it was like 3 o'clock in the morning. He's going down at like 150 miles an hour and ends up crashing into the back of this woman, killing her and her dog. But the impact didn't kill her. It was the car caught fire and they burned to death. So pretty messed up.
Jesus.
But for the most part, like NFL players can kind of get out of pretty much anything, but this is like the riddle, the test here is like, all right, are we gonna let millionaires, you know, run the show, or are we actually gonna show there's some kind of repercussion to it? Right now he's facing like 60 years for jail. And
wow,
you know, that's something you got to see like a Steve Bannon get, you know, throw a charge like sure. that at yeah. him, you know, really make a butthole sweat.
Yeah. One last thing. Attorney General Merrick Garland said Bannon's indictment reflects the Justice Department's steadfast commitment to ensuring the department adheres to the rule of law. Each count carries a minimum of 30 days of jail and a sentence of up to one year behind bars. So, yeah.
Okay. So 1 year. Yeah. All right. 1 year. Sure.
Yeah. Sure. Something. Sure. Up to 1 year. Yeah. Sure.
Not for disobeying stuff about treasonous actions towards your country. Sure.
Yeah, okay, cool. inciting treasonous actions. Exactly. So, speaking of powerful people getting away with bullshit. You have watched many episodes of Succession. Last I knew, you were up to episode 2, season 2. What do you, what's the latest update there, buddy?
I think I finished episode 3 of season 2. And so, we'll get some spoilers, I guess. Want some spoilers?
Yes, well, spoilers for everything, spoilers? Everything right. always.
So Shiv got the proposition to become the new executive CEO of Waystar at some point.
Yes.
And yes. That's where we are now. Okay. And man, I mean, all the characters are just wholly unlikable. You know, and they do a great job. This is what I actually really like about the show, that there you'll find these times where you're like bonding with a character. Not like bonding, but like, okay, you're my new favorite
asshole
character of the show. And then something happens where it's just like, oh my God, like you are annoying. And I'm lucky there's 6 other characters in this show. Otherwise I'd stop watching because you piss me off so bad right now. Like Kendall, like sometimes I'm behind him and now he's got this whole whipped dog, Ted Kennedy kind of thing going on. His brother, Romulus. He's funny. You know, he's funny all the time with the stuff he says. It's just like, oh, jerk me. It's like Steve Stifler from American Pie in Succession, you know, just saying like these, how did you even put those two adjectives together with that obscenity in there, you know?
Yeah,
and then he'll do this 180 where he's just full of self-doubt like constantly like, well, if I did this, but if I did that, and it's just like, fucking make a decision and go with it.
Do something.
Like, and you can tell he's got this inferiority complex. And it's just, and in between Shiv and Tom, and it's like Tom just, he's constantly crying all the time. There's this part where it's like, oh, Tom's actually not a bad dude. And then it's just like, oh, well, actually, wait, he still wants power. And he's super, super soft. And if he doesn't get it, he's just going to cry. It's just like, Christ, you guys. Oh.
Yeah, fantastic show. I'm fully caught up, obviously. Been talking about it. Third season is going to be fifth episode of the third season is coming out Sunday. So you're blasting through these, so you should be able to catch up before the end of this season.
Usually I'm firing out one a night, but if I miss one, I end up catching two later on. I'll probably watch a couple tonight, see how it goes.
Yeah, yeah. Great characters, great side characters. I love Stewie. Love the character Stewie. Stewie. Just pulled up some quotes from Stewie. He's like, he's talking to Roman. He's like, dude, you look like a dildo dipped in beard trimmings.
Yep. I passed that line recently. Man. Yeah, there's always something that it's like, they say something, I want to write it down. So when you send all those gifts in group chat, I can just like type it out and just be like, no, here you go. I don't know, I can spend the time looking for a gift. I'm just going to make a quote book from now on and just start pulling from it.
Yeah.
Amazing. It's always in the beginning of the episode too, where it's like, that was actually hilarious. And then it's just like, I should write that down. I'm like, no, I'll remember it. Guess what? I never remember it, but I know it was funny.
Tom and Greg, I think, have everyone's favorite dynamic on this show. Tom says to Greg, you know, you have to break some Gregs to make a Tomlet. One of the best quotes of the show.
Yeah. He was doing that thing where he's just like, I'm going to need you to be a punching bag today. He's like, oh, cool, great, yeah. He's like, come on, Greg, I need you. I'm going to come in hard on you.
So Greg is just the most like awkward, cringy character I've ever seen on a show. Just cannot get out what the fuck he's trying to say. He's always like, you know, like he said, double thinking, overthinking everything he's going to say to somebody, just the most. But I feel like that he is the type of person, if you stuck a normal, quote unquote, normal person into this group dynamic, they would be that person. They would be Greg. You know, just that.
Have no idea how to cope with any of this and basically just going along for a ride and thinking that, like, hey, I'm here to do some good work. And like, there's nobody here doing good work. And eventually it's going to drag him down and eat him up. If someone had to die, it would likely be Greg. If somehow like something, some situation arose where it's like, all right, he's the innocent one, the naive one that's going to put too much trust in somebody, and it's going to end up costing his life or something like that. If the show takes that direction, he'd be the first one on the list to go.
Yeah, I love the Tom. Just digs at Greg all the time. Tom from I forget the actor's name, but he was Mr. Darcy in Pride and Prejudice, which we watched last year. So interesting seeing him in this type of role. He says to Tom, I think it was maybe the first episode or second episode of the first season. He says to Greg, quote, are we talking to each other on the deck of a majestic schooner? Is the salty brine stinging my weather-beaten face? No? Then why the fuck are you wearing a pair of deck shoes, man?
It's honestly hilarious. Like Tom, man. Like at times where he's just kind of like tripping over his words and just like super awkward. Like he has that.
Yeah,
he has that. I don't know. He's a wordsmith, you know, a master of the witty shit coming out of his mouth. But it all depends on who he's talking. He's got to be punching down, you know. He can't be punching up.
Exactly.
Like he's starting to get a little bit with Shiv, but it's like real short. Like she was like shitting on him.
Yeah.
Her and Romulus were talking about how his suits don't fit, and she was just like, "He's like Shiv, fuck off." And it's like, "Oh shit, here we go." Finally. And then like 30 minutes later, he's crying because of something she did, and I'm like, "Oh, you bitch."
It's very fascinating seeing the different power dynamics between each character. Like you said, Tom is very subservient to Shiv and to Roman a little bit, but especially Logan. Well, everyone's subservient to Logan, but yeah, it's very interesting seeing Tom's behavior change drastically depending on who he's talking to, right? You know, in the newest season, Tom is talking to Kendall, and Tom is just like, hey, what's up, man? What's up? What's going on? We're still bros? We're still good? Yeah, bro. Everything's good. I hate how Kendall also, you know, just like everyone changes their personality based on the situation they're in and the person they're talking to, especially Kendall. Like Kendall is just, when he was on his drug trips, right, doing meth with those dudes, he's like, what's up, bro? We're going to do some fucking meth? Let's do it. Let's do some fucking meth. And he's talking to Logan. He's like, yeah, dad. Yes, dad. Whatever you want, dad. Yes, sir.
Yep. It's fucking crazy. I mean, that's where we're at right now with him. And it's funny because it's like he's got that ruthless edge to him now in this season. Like, but the first season was him trying to usurp his father, and you know, something always came up where he just backed off, or you know, for other reasons it was just like he was shook. But like this season, it's just like he never had that push to go the final distance. But like I just watched him dismantle the company that he brought in. What was it? It started with a V.
Yeah, Valter.
Valter, yeah, he'd straight up dismantle Valter just because his dad told him to. And for a second there, you thought like oh shit, okay, he's gonna operate within his own bubble here, you know, try to help these guys out because it's his baby. And then he just like ruthlessly just fucking, he's just like, all right, you guys got 15 minutes to leave. Scared to walk you out. Here's the papers. Just get the fuck out of here. Get the fuck out. It's like, where was that when you're like trying to take down your dad? He has the worst timing out of everybody. I don't know. That's the biggest frustration with him for me, at least. It's just like, fucking show this edge 24/7. You're so awesome. Yeah, I mean, not awesome, but you're so like a man of your convictions when you're high on cocaine, you know? Like, fucking do it when you're sober, you little bitch. Come on.
Yeah, but you know, they're all under the thumb of Logan. Everyone's working for Logan.
Oh, yeah,
nobody has the balls to say anything. Nobody has the balls to say anything to Logan ever. I think the only time, I don't know if you're there yet, but when they were discussing buying out that that other like news company that's supposed to be like, you know, the progressive news
PBR
company
as opposed to something like that. PBM.
Yeah. They went to their cottage or whatever, their summer house or whatever, and they were discussing buying it. And that's the only time you ever see Logan in a position, or any time you see anybody talking to Logan, not being subservient, not being, you know, so like, yes, sir, whatever, sir, is when it's somebody that's not working for him, you know?
Yeah. So. Well, I mean, even that scene there, though, it was like, I think you talked about when he was making them oink like pigs and sausage, he was playing the game with them.
Yeah.
Where he was just like, do you think me taking over this company is a good idea? And one of them was like, yeah. And he's like, a liar, get over there on the floor. And then like the next one was like, no. Or Romulus was like, I think this is a good idea, blah, blah, blah. And he's just like, and he let him sit down. So then Greg was like, he's like, Greg, what do you think? And he's just like, yeah, this is a great idea. He's like, liar, go sit on the ground. It's just like, you don't know which way he's coming from. Yeah. Like he's throwing you a left hook, a right hook, an uppercut. Yeah.
Yeah.
And I mean, that's good. I mean, that's how he kind of stays on top. Not to mention that he's fucking emotionally beating these people, his children into ground them into dust.
Yeah. Yeah. It's mad, I mean, man. All that stuff. All of that, what do you call that when you're like in a fraternity, or the hazing stuff,
all of that
emotional and physical abuse sometimes, that's all part of, you know, the toxic masculinity of culture and of the corporate world. And that's all the stuff people just don't see ever, because most people aren't part of that culture or part of that world. And it's just like, yeah, that stuff probably happens all the time on a lesser extent. Just that nobody ever talks about it.
They're covering up those cruises or whatever, you know? And it's funny because the Washington football team have like a situation with that with cheerleaders where the owner was basically pimping them out to other rich people on yachts, you know? So, I mean, these are like real world events that they're not even dramatizing for a show. Like this actually happens. And there's like countless scenes where I'm like, this is how a stripper ends up dead in a hotel room, you know, like, like you could just see the brewing hate and anger underneath, like someone like Kendall, like when he gets those dead eyes or those drug tripped out eyes or those blank eyes, whatever. He's got different faces for everything. It, like, they looks like the same look, but his eyes are like telling you this story. Just like, it's like, I might kill a bitch tonight. I might do it.
Yes. Yes. Yep. Yep. Yeah, that's incredible that we've only had one death so far. Billionaires. Yeah. Yeah. There's like I said, there's no repercussions, except sometimes, maybe. We'll see. So yeah, you know, like I said, I don't want this discussion to be like, yeah, they're all terrible people all the time, but they are. But so yeah. What is, who would, like, if there's one person, yeah, they're all terrible people, but if you had to pick one person to be like, I'd like to at least hang out with that one person for once, for for maybe a couple hours one time, who would it be? Would it be Kendall?
Yeah, man. I mean, if I was go with maybe narrow it down to the four siblings or whatever. And yeah. I think it'd have to be Kendall. Honestly, Romulus would be a little bit too intimidating for my. I feel like it'd just be a roast constantly. And Kendall, I don't know. I feel like you can kind of control Kendall. Like, if he thinks he can control you, that's one thing. Yeah. But like, if you get on his level and he looks at you as an equal, he's probably the most chill of the bunch. Fucking what? Yeah. Connor, man, he's a lunatic.
I was just gonna mention him.
Good Lord.
he's so delusional. He has complete lack of self-awareness of just how dopey he is, right?
No, yeah, he doesn't have any of that. He wants to be president of the United States, and he wants everybody to take him seriously. And everyone's like, yeah. Bro.
His
video that he made was like, we're not going to pay taxes. And the family's like, well, you can't say that. Don't say that. We have arrangements in place. Don't rock that boat.
Yeah, exactly. Did you get to the part yet where asked Logan?
You know what? I take back the Kendall thing. Hold on. I take back the Kendall thing.
Yeah.
I want to hang out with Shiv because there's a chance I get lucky because apparently she just fucks anything that walks.
not Jerry? You wouldn't fuck Jerry?
Huh?
Would you fuck Jerry?
What the fuck, Jerry?
Roman wants the fuck. Do you think Roman actually wants a few?
Yeah, I feel like that's going to happen. Actually, that's going to happen.
Jerry.
There was a scene recently. He's just like, I can't remember how that went down. He's just like, if I wasn't super drunk right now, I might make a move on you or something. He said something like that, and she just like. She had to rearrange his tie or something, or zip his zipper. I don't remember one of the things, but it's just like, it's going to happen. Those two are going to plow.
Yep, absolutely. Yeah, crazy show. One of the best shows on TV. What was I saying about Connor? I forget now.
Yeah, I feel like I interrupted you just so I could get that Shiv thing in before I forget. Right. Connor's a psycho.
Connor's a doofus.
He's the one that's going to kill somebody.
Sure. Yeah. Oh, I was asking you, did you get to the part yet where he asked Logan for a bunch of money, like a lot of money?
No, I haven't gotten there yet.
Okay. Yeah.
Is it for his presidential run?
Yes. Well, is he doing his play yet? He made he directed a play, I think, that he is not going well.
Oh, okay. Okay. Was it his girlfriend's play?
Yeah.
Okay. Nope, not there yet. She's been talking about it. So
okay, all right, yeah, just
seeing a couple episodes of it.
Yeah, one of the things I really like about the show, and I guess it's something Jesse Armstrong, the writer of the show, is known for. It's sort of the quick, fast paced, you know, dialogues you see in Scrubs, you see in, you know, like we've been talking about. Aaron Sorkin's dialogue, that quick repartee, that quick witty back and forth banter, right? But on top of that, you also have those moments, especially when Logan's in the room, of people just, you know, stuttering and stammering. Not even Greg, like almost every person in the room when they're talking to Logan or about Logan, or they're having somebody will have a moment where they're just like stammering and stuttering and talking over each other. And I think that's really, really, you know, organic and authentic. Dialogue that you don't really see very much, very often in other things.
Yeah. I mean, it does sound more like it's his children to do the stammering and the stuttering. Like the older people that like Frank and Jerry, like unless they're confronted with like an opinion like about buying that media conglomerate or whatever.
Yeah.
Like, then they get a little tongue tied. But they're also older and among his trusted peers or whatever, where they know how to be a yes man, you know, and, right. and that's how they survive, basically. So I don't really feel like there's a whole lot, I don't know, in comparison to like his children, but like they just know how to survive in that element. Like he has that air of power where he's like, he's submitted these people successfully. And then like his kids are like the yeah. ones that are like still kind of hanging around and to get in line. But I feel like, don't you feel like at some point, like if someone was just a straight up talk to him, like a man, say something with some conviction, like he'd respect that, you know? Like I feel like he's waiting for Kendall yeah, to do that. Just be like,
yeah.
fucking say something with some like with your nuts, you know, in your hand, like, oh, these are my balls, this make me yeah. feel it, you know,
but
like make me fear that, you like the world fears me, like I think that's what he's looking for.
I'm yeah, he might respect strength, but then also you have to know, he just knows their kids, like he's they're Logan's kids, and Logan just knows them in and out, and he's raised them in such a way to be like, you will praise me, you will show fealty to me all the time, always. He's conditioned yeah. these
I
kids.
I made all this for you, so you have
he's,
to
he's conditioned these kids to my torture. Understand. He's conditioned them to understand, to show fealty and show loyalty all the time. And if they break out of that, then they get punished. They don't, they're in their world, there is no reward for nutting up. There is no reward for showing yeah. strength or showing anything but absolute loyalty to Logan. So that's a big reason nobody ever talks back to Logan.
It's crazy too, because they all know that, you know, like Kendall, Logan had this line where he's just like, they're doing the biography and he doesn't want anybody talking about the biography. And immediately he's like, Kendall, was it you? And he's just like, Dad, no, come on. And he's just like, Dad, it wasn't me. And he's like, oh, okay. It's just usually when someone betrays me, it's you. And it's, you know, it's that kind of thing where it's, I don't know.
It's a Stockholm syndrome thing too, of just like, you're in this situation, you're in a toxic, abusive relationship for so long that you think it's normal and you think it's okay. you don't know any better. You don't know what a quote unquote normal relationship is supposed to look like. So you're conditioned to think that this is normal.
Yeah. Yeah. That's what I think yeah. Romulus has, is just like, everything is just like, well, I'm not supposed to act like this. Come on.
Yeah.
Although that yeah. dude just really needs a hug, you know, that's all he needs. What can I ask you about the, what do you think about the way it's filmed? Like it has that camera yeah. shake, like it's a documentary.
Yeah. Yeah. Really good.
You know? Yeah, really? I thought that was interesting. I wasn't expecting that. Like the first episode, it's just like they had the camera in their face and it was like a little shaky. Like it was like a, like they were filming a scene from The Office or something like that. And I was like, oh, okay, interesting. But yeah. it adds like this tension to it. This like kind of, say, like this realness, you know, it's yeah. not like this like super produced thing where the camera's like steady. It's just like, when the camera's shaking, it's just like, oh, like a sudden jolt, or like you can feel like the tremble. I don't know. It's an interesting element yeah. that I wasn't expecting from the show. And I think it's a good touch.
It is a very good touch. Joanna Robertson does a weekly recap of the show every week. And she was talking to one of the directors and they were saying how when they film the show, they have, you know, one camera. They don't choreograph any of the movements. So if you notice people just walking around, they're just walking around. They don't, the camera guy doesn't know where they're going. And so that does lend to the authenticness of it. So there was one of the actors was saying, you know, okay, in this scene, I'm going to walk around, I'm going underneath the table, I'm going to go here. And the director was like, no, don't tell them where you're going to go. Just do it in the moment. So it does, so you do capture this feel of authenticity.
Yeah. Now you say that, there was a scene where Logan and Kendall was in Logan's office after he dismantled Walter and he was explaining how he did it and everything. And he's just like, all right. And then Romulus walks in and he was like, I'm going to have Kendall on the across from us on the board. And Kendall got pissed and he told him to get the fuck out. And then he's just like, he's like, Kendall, go ahead, have a seat. Like a letting the dog in the house, you know, like, okay, you can get yeah. on the couch, you know, that kind of thing. Like, he's just like, have a seat. Yeah. And it's like you were saying where there's no like direction where the people are walking. Kendall did this thing where it's yeah. kind of like he's looking around like, all right. And he walks over to the window. stares out the window for a second, then walks out into the spare room over to the side and just sits down. It was just this weird like path to take. And you mentioning that, it's just like, I mean, they probably scripted that a little bit, but like if they didn't, like that just fits like perfectly with what you said. And I just thought it was odd looking at it. Like, but it really felt like, hey, this is a whipped dog and he just got thrown a bone. And it's like, all right, yeah, you can go sit on the couch. Go ahead. Good boy.
Yeah. Not to spoil anything in the future, but this is one of the best season finales of all time. I'll just say that. Just to
season
keep
two.
Keep the carrot. Season two, the end of season two. Just so you know, if you're watching, you're like, okay, fucking this guy just needs to do something. If he doesn't do something, I'm gonna be fucking pissed. Just to keep that, you know, carrot in front of you, I'd be like, yes, there's a major,
oh, baby, it's not
major
going
turn.
I feel
there's
like
a
that
major
every
turn. Major turn coming in at the end of the season. Yeah. Fucking great show. Yep. Succession.
There's two constant emotions. It's just fucking someone fucking do the thing. And two, this theme song is a banger. Those are my two thoughts always remaining constant throughout the whole show.
Yes. One of the best theme songs of all time. Again, because I'm such a nerd about this stuff and I deep dive in everything. I was watching a video talking to the conductor, but the music choreographer or whatever he's called, how he came up with that tune and how he sort of integrates that theme song into the show over the course of the show and sort of does these weird chord progressions that he talked about the chord progression off the beginning, which is like da 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 da, and he's like, this is a, you know, B, whatever it was, B major flat into a this thing, and because there's a flat, because there's a what do you call the note that's positive and note that's negative, whatever it's called, but he throws in like the entire chord is upbeat except for this one little part that makes you feel off guard or makes you feel very uneasy, this one little
anxious.
Note in there. So
anxious
yeah exactly. So very interesting the way he,
you know what part does that for me in the song, it's like beep when he fucking hits that one key. That's the part where it just like spikes me.
Yeah. Yeah. It's a minor note in a major chord. So it's a very like, ooh, I like most of that, but what was that little, well, that little turn in the middle there? Weird little ingredient in there. Yeah.
Wasn't a fan of that. Always Sunny in Philadelphia. They went on Family Feud and they kept doing the buzzer and fucking Dennis was freaking out. He's just like, I don't like that noise. I don't like that noise. And he kept covering his ears. And by the end of the show, they just kept leaning on the buzzer and he's in fetal position on the floor at Family Feud. Hilarious. Hilarious episode. That's how I feel though. It's just like, that was jarring.
Yeah, I would like to, you know, someday talk to somebody that's like in this field or in this upper echelon of society of just like, is this your life? Are you okay? Do you need a hug? Because if this is anything, if Succession is anything like real life.
How do you even come across that? Just like, you got this piano in your kitchen, you're eating your Cheerios and you're just having a rough morning and you're like, do, 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 do.
Yeah.
Hey, fucking throw your Cheerios against your wall or something like that.
Yeah. Yep. So, let's see. Let's move on. I watched a couple movies. I went back to the theater a couple times since Dune. We saw Dune a few weeks ago, and that triggered, like, movies. They're awesome. I love them. I forgot how awesome they are and the experience and all that. And so I think 2 weeks after that, I went and saw Eternals. New MCU film from the Oscar winner Chloe Zhao, directed by her, written by her, starring Gemma Chan, Richard Madden, Angelina Jolie, Selma Hayek, Kit Harington, Kumail Nanjiani, bunch of people in this movie. This movie, oof, oof, that's all I'll say. Oof, moving on, oof.
Oh man, oof. Really? Such a blockbuster, and that's all you got to say, huh?
O-O-F. Oof. It is
so rough. It was just a movie. Was it just because it was a long movie or was it because it was just too many characters that buckled down and introduce everybody with a proper backstory? Yes. Like was it too ambitious?
Yes, all of that. You nail it on the head with the yeah. ambitious, with it's too big, way too many characters. Like there's 10 people in this movie. Like that, what did I just name off? Like 7 people? It's too many to care about. The more people you have in this movie, it's harder to care about. You cut that down to like 5, then yes, it makes it a lot easier to keep track of all these people. Oh, that's what I was going to say. So coming up, we got, you know, Eternals, big movie. We got Dune, big movie. We got Wheel of Time, big story. Big story going to be on TV. It's going to be very interesting to see if Wheel of Time, being a television show, will be able to tell its story in a much neater fashion. You know, it's going to be much easier to follow the story and follow the characters and follow the plot if it's presented as a TV show as opposed to a movie? Because I feel like, you know, Dune did really well at, you know, conveying its story, getting its story across in a 2.5-hour format. And it'll be interesting to see how much easier it is to consume that type of story in a, you know, 1-hour format as opposed to a movie. And I feel like Eternals did not do well at conveying a large scale story in a 2.5-hour format. Yeah, like I said, just too many stories, too many characters, too many backstories to keep track of, too many motivations to keep track of. The MCU and blockbusters and movies like this bank on having a good bad guy. The bad guy has to be relatable, has to be charismatic, and you have to understand and sympathize with the reasons he's doing what he's doing. I've said this before, you know, 1,000 times. Every time we talk about MCU films or blockbuster films, it's always, was the bad guy good or not? You know, you either have a good movie with a good bad guy or you don't. And the bad guy in this is, can I talk about this? Do you want me to talk about this? Are you going to see this?
Yeah, go ahead. No.
So Richard Madden, Icarus, he betrays the Eternals because the Eternals were put there by a celestial named, let me see if I can find the name here, Ereshkigal. Ereshkigal is a celestial. So right there you have celestials and Eternals, these two things that sound the same but are very different. The celestials created the Eternals, and the celestials created the Eternals to basically do what Ego did. Tried to do in Guardians 2, which was to terraform and to colonize the galaxy with people like them. So the Eternals, the Celestials, put the Eternals on Earth thousands of years ago to help populate the Earth. They had to populate the Earth in order to make enough whatever, people juice, energy juice, to awaken another celestial. The way celestials are born in this world, apparently, is that they are little baby celestial egg is implanted into the egg of the Earth, right? Just like, you know, when a celestial daddy and an Earth mommy love each other very much, they make a celestial, apparently. So
thank you for that sex education.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Intergalactic sex education.
Yes. So apparently the egg in the Earth is ready to pop. They have 7 days from the beginning of this movie for the celestial to awaken. And when he awakens, the Earth just explodes. And so when they find out this information, they find out that Icarus knew the whole time. And so Icarus betrays them and starts fighting them to prevent them from preventing the celestial from awakening. So it's just the end of this movie. The last third of this movie is just another cookie cutter, generic, you know, fighty fighty, big fighty fighty, flying laser beams, punchy punchy fight scene that we've seen 1,000 times. So that wasn't great.
Gotcha.
Yeah. Also,
do you think a movie?
Yeah, go ahead.
A movie like that would be a better TV show, TV series?
Yeah, I mean that's what I was saying. It was just, you know, a very big story, big scope. I think it was doomed to fail. I think to make this a movie was not a great idea. I think they needed to make this a TV show. I think it, you know, you have such a grand scope and so many characters and such a big scale, time scale, and just so many things going on that making this a 2.5-hour movie was, you just couldn't do it. It was an impossible task for anybody, even Chloe Zhao. Like, she's a really good director, really good screenwriter, but just failed on launch, whatever that's called. Just, yeah. You have a moment in here where you have a guy named, what's his name? Fotos, played by Brian Tyree Henry, who basically is the tech guy of the group. He introduces the human race to technology and helps them progress in that area. So at one point they're explaining, you know, where were the Eternals during Thanos? Where were the Eternals during all of the Holocaust and all of the major world events and all of these major disasters? And so they have this moment during after the Hiroshima bombing. They zoom in and Festos and somebody else is there crying because, oh my God, we caused this thing to happen. It's just so tone deaf that you're just saying, like, using this massive, one of the worst, you know, atrocities to ever happen in the history of humanity and just being like, yeah, this fake person caused this thing. It's just, no, don't do that. don't use that. Use one of the worst moments in human history as a crutch to be like, yeah, this is why this fake character is sad. That's not a great thing to do,
in my opinion. Do you think they should keep that like out of everything? Like, figure Magneto's backstory is he's a Holocaust survivor.
Yeah.
Do you think they could do without that? Or do you think that takes away from his character?
It's just, no. Just don't invoke it is the word I'm trying to think of. They invoke a very awful time. And it's just a way to say, this person did this. This person caused this, and now they're sad, and they're never going to engage with humanity again because they caused so much destruction. It's just like, no, don't do that. You know, it was a human caused event. It was a human caused tragedy, and just saying that it was caused by an alien or
deflecting blame off of Hitler. Hitler wasn't that bad of a dude because it wasn't his fault.
Well, they specifically I agree that yes, saying it wasn't Hitler's fault is like, oh, he was a fucking this whole time Hitler was a what they call it, the transforming people. Hitler was a Skrull, so therefore humans aren't that bad.
A Skrull.
Yeah, no, fuck that.
What about Hydra? Well, isn't Hydra basically the Nazis?
Hydras are the Nazis. Yes. So you could do that.
Hitler
was a Hydra.
I mean, it is an interesting, when you think about it, you're like, oh, this is like, this could be interesting. Like, okay, if superheroes were to exist, there has to be some kind of atrocity that happened. Almost like a God thing. Like, you're an omnipotent all powerful. But do you stand by and watch like when this happens? Like, how can you justify superheroes in a world where, you know, such terrible things such as the Holocaust it could happen? And I can see where someone would be like, let's delve into that a little bit. And but it's like you're saying, I mean, I didn't watch it, but it's not clean, you know? It's just like there's really no way that like someone wouldn't have taken care of that. Okay, like, so this person's responsible for the Holocaust happening. Well, I mean, like, how come nobody else, like, you know, might have stepped in or something like that?
Yeah.
I don't know. It's just weird. If one person can be responsible for it, why are there, like, how many other superheroes are there by this point? Like, why couldn't one of them stop it or something? I don't know. It's this weird road to go down.
Yeah. It's hard to keep track of. They have so many different times in history they go back to. They go back to Gilgamesh. They go back to, you know, the dawn of human civilization up to, you know, like the 1700s. So they're constantly flashing back and forward to current time, then to back time, then to olden times, then to this time, and it's very hard to keep track of. One of the big things is they, you know, advertised Kit Harington's going to be in this movie with Richard Madden. Kit Harington is not in this movie with Richard Madden. Kit Harington is in about 3.5 minutes of this movie, so that was not a great advertising
plan
there. Yep.
Really?
Really.
Is it by, like, I've never followed the Eternals at all. Like,
yeah, me neither.
Is he not a key player?
Nope.
Like,
nope. He's not Eternal. Kit Harington, spoiler alert, is not an Eternal.
Did he think he was? And it just, like, sorry, bud.
He was the
job for you.
He was the, what do you call it, audience proxy. He was a human being. So he's the guy, he's the person in every movie. You know, you have that one person that doesn't know what's going on. So the other person has to explain it to that person so the audience can catch up, you know. So he's that guy.
Wow, yeah. Well, I mean, he does know nothing.
True. So I don't want to go on.
I mean, he didn't want it, you know. So
So I don't want to go off too long because I got other things to talk about, and also I don't like talking about things I don't like.
All right.
So yeah.
I must have tortured you for the last 12 minutes.
Not great. So no. I think it's important to say why you don't like things just as much as important to say why you do like things. So yeah.
Well, I mean, I'm going to check it out at some point when it's free on Disney Plus. So we'll circle back to it in next month.
One thing about the theater going experience, packed theater on our Thursday night, nice crowd, good crowd. Except the guy directly behind me was snoring the entire time, so that was not great.
Oh, literally, man, that's
literally
tough.
The entire
must
movie.
Must have been a real banger of a movie.
Literally,
needed
the
Succession
time.
Theme in there at some point.
Yeah,
bing, that'll wake his ass up.
Yeah, yeah, not great. Oh, and also I touched you this, but I went. What did I do? I went the night before to see Last Night in Soho. The fucking speakers were blown out, so I had to walk back home. It's not a long walk. It's not a long walk, but not a short walk, but it's like fucking 30 degrees out where we are right now. So that wasn't great.
It's a walk you didn't want to make.
It was a walk I didn't want to make, and I had to make it. So I had to go out Wednesday night, Thursday night. Thursday night I saw Eternals. Next week I saw Last Night in Soho. So I'll pivot to that. I'll make a nice little segue to that. Last Night in Soho, one of the most anticipated, said it right the first time, most anticipated films of 2021. Remember that when we were going through that list of movies for the year?
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
You did mention that. Yes, you did.
Yep. Yep. Directed by Mr. Edgar Wright, Mr. Scott Pilgrim vs. the World, Shaun of the Dead fame. Great, great director, great writer. Love all his movies. This is starring Thomasin McKenzie from Jojo Rabbit. Some other people. What was her name? See, the other thing about Mr. IMDb, if you're listening, your site is bullshit because you have cast in credits order. Don't put them in credits order. Put them in order of who the fuck I know. I don't know Rita Tungsingham or Colin McMackey or Siobhan Carlson. Put the freaking person at the top who we know. Anna Taylor-Joy is in this film. And Matt Smith, who played the Doctor Who, for a long time. So they're very good in this. What is your opinion on Matt Smith? Let me put him in the thing. If I said Matt Smith to you, can you conjure a face to that name in your mind?
There is no face being conjured.
All right. Let me open up his IMDb's and I will post it in the Discord. And you give me your gut reaction to this man's face.
All right.
Gut reaction, first reaction, raw reaction.
Oh,
don't hold back. What you got?
I have to poop, but somebody hit me in the face with a 2x4. But I can smell the poop coming.
So, for those that don't know, you didn't paint him a very good word picture. Matt Smith has a Cro-Magnon face. He has the Neanderthal face, right?
Like it looks like he ran into a wall really, 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 really fast.
Right. He has a very pronounced brow, very pronounced forehead, right?
If you shaved his head, he looks like one of those orcs from Lord of the Rings.
Yeah, exactly.
Put some war paint on him and definitely an orc understudy.
Yeah, this guy I watched all of his, Matt Smith. I've watched all of his run as Doctor Who. He did about 3 or 4 seasons as Doctor Who. Love Doctor Who. One of my favorite sci-fi shows of all time. He played a very good Doctor Who. He looks like a very good Doctor Who because Doctor Who is an alien. He's a Time Lord, so he's not human. So that face and that body and all of that thing that he has going on worked very well for that role because he's supposed to look unique and otherworldly, right? He looks like somebody not of this world, right?
Yeah. It looks like his skin doesn't like properly fit when you catch him at a certain angle.
Yeah. Sorry, I don't mean to be mean, but just, you know, he has a very unique face, a very unique looking gentleman.
Yes, he does. He's a very talented man. Very talented.
Very
he looks talented better
man.
Than me.
Very good. Very good man. I'm sure he's a nice man. I'm sure he's very good at what he does. But just
you can say whatever
looking.
You want. You just got to follow with, he looks better than me still.
I guess
he's
I
mean, rocking he has, the shit out of that suit. He's rocking the shit out of that suit, bud.
Sure. I mean, he has a full head of hair. He has that glow about him. He has that X factor that all A-list actors have. Sure.
Yeah, I mean, like it smells like he's smelling something nasty, but at the same time, it's kind of like I mean, it's got that look like E, and it's like that could work.
Yeah, some of these, yeah. Anyways, let me get back to the actual thing we're talking about here. Last Night in Soho, Nesmith is in this, and it's very, it's, I bring up his looks because he's supposed to be playing, you know, a very charming, very dashing young man, very, very, you know, you look at him and you're just like, ooh, I want to want some of that. Yes, please.
Ride that mustache.
I would ride that mustache. I would ride that, that ridge on his face. But, you know, he first comes around and you're just like, woof, wow. You know, Anya Taylor-Joy wants that? Really? Okay. All right. I guess so. But so this movie.
And I mean, and Anya Taylor-Joy, like she has her own uniqueness to her, we'll say, you know? Yeah. So, I mean, I could see where it just, I feel like we, I've had this conversation with you before.
I know. Yeah, you have.
It's just, it's like awkward, unique is like the new sexy, or at least they're trying to bring that up. Like, I don't know, you find more people these days that break that traditional mold of what is attractive, what is handsome.
Exactly.
Where like, maybe it's a person you wouldn't even really give a second look. Like, I remember the first thing I noticed about Anya Taylor-Joy was, man, her eyes don't seem like they're like a proper distance apart. And then, but you know, you watch enough of the stuff that she's in and she's like, yeah, she's actually very attractive, you know? And like, if I watch enough of this Matt Smith stuff, I'd be like, all right, I got it. You're a good looking dude. I see
you. Sure.
I was just being hard on you.
So this movie, Last Night in Soho, let me read the description here. An aspiring fashion designer is mysteriously able to enter the 1960s where she encounters a dazzling wannabe singer. But glamour is not all that it appears to be, and the dreams of the past start to crack and splinter into something darker. So this is a movie about where Thomasin McKenzie plays the aspiring fashion designer. She goes to London. She goes to fashion school, school of fashion, whatever, and is that weird outcast, doesn't, you know, she's the quiet weirdo, nobody wants to be around her. So she gets a new apartment, and at night she goes on these weird, like, you know, transcendental dreamlike trips throughout 1960s London. And I thought that that's what this movie is going to be about, of like her going back in time and maybe witnessing a murder and having to solve that murder, and her you know, collaborating with Anya Taylor-Joy throughout the rest of the movie. And it's really not that. Anya Taylor-Joy stops appearing in this movie about halfway in. Again, like, just like with Eternals, you put this person on the poster, you put them in the trailers, you put them everywhere, and they stop appearing in the movie about, you know, halfway in. It's just, stop, don't do that. you're selling me a false bill of goods again. But blue ball on me. It transforms into a movie that I didn't think it was going to be. You said this about, what was it? About The Nest, where you said like the director didn't know what the movie was. He didn't have a very control over the tone and what the story was and what kind of movie he was trying to make. And I disagreed with you then. But I think if you watch this movie, I think you would agree. You would have the same feelings then that you do now about this movie, where it's just, is it a fantasy? Is it a crime thriller? Is it a drama? Is it a horror? It has all of these different genres of movie mashed together. And I feel like sometimes that works, but it really doesn't here. Like, I don't know what movie I'm trying to watch here, what movie these characters are in. I feel like Thomasin McKenzie is a very good actress. I feel like she was miscast in this. So I didn't really care for this movie again. I sent you a couple texts this week of, yeah. Sent you a couple texts this week of just, like, this is a movie.
You might have sold me on that pitch you just did.
Oh,
saying okay. How it reminds you of The Nest. I'm interested to see the movie that I was trying to describe to you.
Yeah.
Like, you finally, it sounds like you might have finally watched it, and you might have actually felt the way I felt. So I am interested to see if we're on the same wavelength. If I was to watch this movie, I would have a similar reaction to as into watching The Nest. And I'd be yes, that's it. That's the thing. I like that you could recall that too, because that was one of our more contentious arguments.
It was, of course. This does, I'm going to throw some words at you, this does explicitly what The Nest does implicitly. My understanding is explicitly means it's like, this is the thing. I'm showing you the thing. It's a picture of the thing. here's what we're talking about. Implicitly is like more subtle, more nuanced. Like the Nest was implicitly saying this, it got little sprinkles of horror in here, little sprinkles of, you know, tragedy and whatever, different types of movies that are just bubbling underneath the surface and you kind of have to dig for them to look to find them. This is like explicitly saying this is a horror. This is a scene of horror. We're showing you, you know, ghastly images and blah, blah, blah. And this is a scene of, you know, mystery. And this is a scene of fantasy, romance. And so this does like is throwing in your face all of those different genres of movies that you were complaining about with The Nest. And I feel like The Nest, the reason I liked The Nest was that it was just very subtle about placing those different genres in there, about mixing them in. You know what I mean? If it was, like The Nest is like a pie where you have to like dig underneath the edges to find those different genres. And the Last Night in Soho was like a fucking, just like a bean burrito just splattered across the wall. It's just like, here's some horror and here's some drama and here's some whatever. It's just like, calm down. I don't know how to feel in this moment, you know? Very, very, very crazy movie. Yeah. So
I made you a cake. And it has chocolate in it, and cookies, and sour cream, and pineapple,
the pineapples,
and orange juice, and poop.
And poop. I would recommend checking it out if you want to see. Yeah, exactly. Like you said, what I saw in this, what you saw in The Nest. So maybe check that out.
Okay, cool.
Yes. You might. One more film, then we can move on to some other things you've been watching. What we call Titan. Either Titan or Titan. It's a French film, so I'm guessing it's pronounced Titan, like the French. Titan. The synopsis of this movie is... Yeah. Following a series of...
I'm the resident French guy in here, so...
Yes, exactly. Directed by Julia Ducournau. Following a series of unexplained crimes, a father is reunited with the son who has been missing for 10 years. Titan, a metal highly resistant to heat corrosive with high tensile strength alloys. I didn't just go off there to Wikipedia article. This is actually in the synopsis on IMDb. This is a horror movie. This is body horror. This is a body horror film from the same director that did Raw. Raw is about a woman who goes to a veterinary clinic and somehow she adapts the need to eat flesh. She gets the somehow she catches what's the word? She develops the need for flesh, for either human flesh or animal flesh. It was very disgusting. And this is one of the most disgusting movies I've seen in a very long time. The main character, Alexia, has to pretend to be Vincent's son. So she breaks her own nose on a sink, on a ceramic sink. And you hear and you feel and you just see like bones and cartilage being smooshed together. And it's one of the most disgusting things I've ever seen. Yeah. Yeah. So if you
have the sound effect too, the appropriate sound effect.
Yep. Mm. All of that stuff. So this is if you're into body horror, I would highly recommend watching Titan. I believe it's on Prime Video right now. So I won't say much because that is pretty much the synopsis of this. Is she, this woman, dress up as a boy and pretends to be a boy, and it's about you know, playing different roles. It's about, you know, seeing, you know, wanting your son to be alive. If somebody's like, it's about, you know, dealing with death and knowing that, or trying to, you know, bring your dead person back to life, basically, where the father sees this person who's clearly not the kid's son. I think deep down he knows that, but he just wants, you know, some closure, I guess. I don't know. I'm not what I'm trying to say, but it's, you know, it's about that thing where you just are so grief-stricken that you will accept anything in place of your kid being dead. So that's what I took away from that movie.
And another successful pitch.
Yeah, it's called Titan. If you want to rent that on Amazon, I think it was like $5. So that's about all. That's about, yeah. Yes, I believe you. So that's about all I've been watching and you've been watching. Do you want to talk about Ted Lasso? You've been rewatching that this week. How's that been going?
I have been. Turns out I'm not going to file for a divorce from my wife because she likes the show.
Yeah.
He just got it on with Sassy Smurf, and she was it's funny because, you know, I've already watched this, so I'm seeing everything for the I'm seeing things through. I'm looking at her basically watching this. It's like when you tell someone to watch your favorite show, and you're not even paying attention to the show. You're scrutinizing their every. It's like, oh, they didn't laugh at that. That was actually really funny. You should have laughed at that. I'm doing my best. So, but she's reacting well to a lot of the stuff. She laughs internally a lot sometimes, but like when she laughs out loud, it's like, all right, yeah, okay, all right, we got this, we're good. Sometimes I feel like she's a little too quiet, but you know, yeah. she gets there. It's funny because we've been watching it with subtitles on just because Apple TV apparently defaults to that. I don't know. I have to turn them off every single time. It's really obnoxious, but I turned them off because actually I noticed that these subtitles were taken away from the show, and I'm like, we can't watch this with these subtitles on. We gotta take them off because you're not. There's so much emotion in these people's faces. Like, if you were just to read all the words that Sudeikis says and not actually watch his facial expressions, miss so much, and you might not even realize that. Yep. So we turned them off, and we were watching it for like 10 minutes. And sometimes some of the characters have really thick accents, and she's like, I don't know if I can watch this without the subtitles. I'm like, come on, it's not even a foreign language. We got this. But yeah, she's really enjoying it, and that bodes well for us. And it's fun for me to watch a rewatch of it because it's one of my favorite shows of all time now. And sometimes you miss, like, in my head, like the timeline. Like, he's already starting to have panic attacks, and we're only like episode 6. I thought it didn't. Those didn't start happening like till later on. They're 10 episodes, 12 episodes, but
yeah.
So look, it's a fun rewatch, and I encourage anybody that's watched the show to watch it again.
Yeah, fantastic show, really great show. I believe he won for best comedy in Istanbul, whatever it was, the Emmy, the Golden Globe, all that.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah, he had like. Or Ted Lasso had like 3 episodes that were up for the same category. Pretty impressive. It was Bill Lawrence directed one. It was like directed episode Emmy kind of thing. So Bill Lawrence was up for one, and Zach Braff, he was up for one, which is funny because they worked on the same show, but they're competing against each other.
Yep. Yeah, that's funny. Yeah, so still a great show. Yes.
Great show.
Still enjoying it. Nice. Very nice. Are you noticing anything in the second viewing that you didn't notice the first time?
No. Nope.
No.
I'm okay. I'm just really just drinking all of the Ted Lassoisms in, you know? Like my goal to be more like him. We just watched the episode where they had the the darts. I forgot what the fucking game was called.
Oh, the dart,
he played darts with
great quote.
And he had that awesome speech. It's just like, you know, it still gets you. Like sometimes you think like, all right, I heard this, like that initial feeling, like you didn't know what was coming, and you know, the real like, oh man, that was heavy. Like, still hits the same. Like just listening to that speech, and it's just like I was smiling. I was smiling because you know that fucking dude just oozes this optimism. It's insane, and it's crazy too, because in that speech he's saying how he played darts with his dad every Sunday for 6 years before, you know, his dad died. And it's just like,
yep,
oh damn, his dad died, but it's like somehow I'm still smiling because it's not like don't be sad because that happened, be happy because it did. I don't know how that quote actually goes, but you know, be happy for the journey. I don't know, but you know,
don't be sad that just, it went away. Don't be sad that he died. Be sad that it happened. Yeah. Don't be sad that it ended. Be sad that it happened.
Be glad that he's dead. Yeah. Be glad that he's dead. Yeah.
Yeah. Something like that.
Yeah. Something like that.
I really love that speech because it's something I always talk about and think about. It's just, you know, people that aren't curious about other people are assholes, basically. You know, to be empathetic, you have to be curious, and to be curious, you know, and understand.
Ask questions.
Ask questions, exactly. It takes effort.
You can't understand anything if you don't ask questions.
Exactly. I love that speech. One of my favorite speeches of all time. I'm going to take a piss. Why don't we take a break? Then we'll come back and we'll talk about some Invincible. And we're back. Dion, you watched a little bit of Invincible. How are you liking that?
Man, I only watched another episode, so it's slow going. Succession pretty much takes up all my time. But we're moving on from the Omni-Man massacre.
Yeah.
And it's they're trying to figure out what happened. Really, there wasn't a whole lot to say. Still an interesting show. Eventually, yep. I'm going to buckle down and pound out the rest. It probably won't happen until after Succession's out, because it's like, all right, well,
yeah.
Succession episodes are like an hour long.
Yeah.
Also, Invincible is like 40 minutes long. So, yeah, it's a little bit of a time sink, but it has promise. So we'll get to it. I'm gonna get to it. And right. I don't know if I ever talked about it. I mean, have you ever watched Invincible?
No.
Okay. We'll just move on then.
Okay.
I don't know if I brought it up last time we were talking about it, but you asked me to watch Bluey
yep.
at one point, or at least have my kids watch it. And yeah. You suggested it to me and Andy because we both have kids. Anyways, I put it on for my kids. And my youngest kind of vibed with it. My oldest was just like, what's this, dude? Turn it off. This ain't Power Rangers. Shoot. This ain't Henry Danger.
Yeah.
But it turns out Bluey is actually a fun show. And it is a children's show, but it's like a children's show for adults, if that makes any sense to you. Like, the coolest character in it is the dad.
Huh.
And let me explain. The dad, like, the parenting that happens in with Bluey is like real life parenting. It's not like this... Well, I don't know, like Sesame Street kind of stuff, like
yeah.
like being like real and honest and serious. Like you can joke about stuff, but I don't know, the way they presented it was like everything's a learning lesson, and yep. but it has like a more serious tone. Like Bluey, the dad will call Bluey and the brother like little turds, you know. Like that's what I do with my kids. I call my kid turds, you yep. know.
Yep.
And it's just it's relatable for adults, and it's pretty cool to see that, because you knew somewhere along the line that there was some parent out there that just kind of like all right, these kids shows do have a purpose, they do. But imagine you see it on anytime you're like on some kind of Reddit board or something, there's gonna be like a Paw Patrol reference that comes up, and you're gonna see all these parents talking like self-loathing, like, oh my god, I've watched every episode of Paw Patrol, like. Fucking, why are dogs fixing this city's problem? You know, why is all these jobs left in the hands of a 13-year-old kid? Like, where is your actual police force? You know, like, this is what parents do when they watch a ridiculous show like this.
Yeah.
24/7.
Right.
So to watch Bluey and like have like the dad talking to their kids like you would talk to your kids, it's just, it's very refreshing and it's fun. So
nice.
I don't know where you were thinking it was going to go when you suggested Bluey to us, but I actually like it, and I like it for me, not even for my kids. The twist.
Yeah. Go ahead. Oh, it's a twist. It is a twist. I thought you said the twist is.
Yeah, no, the twist is that I like it's it for twist. Me and not for my children.
Yeah, it's always nice when there's like a, you know, Pixar thing or like a whatever thing that's, you know, made for kids. Well, not for kids, but it's animated and it's got like, you know, no violence, no swearing, but it's also got a little bit of something there for the adults too. It's always nice.
Yep. Absolutely.
Yep. Let's see. Let me talk a little bit about Wheel of Time because I'm still charging through this. I'm on book 5 of 14 and each book is 36 hours. It is a goddamn torturous just venture throughout these books. Let me read the, not synopsis, but like the tagline for the Wheel of Time, because it's a pretty cool tagline. The Wheel of Time turns and ages come and go, leaving memories that become legend. Legend fades to myth, and even myth is long forgotten when the age that gave it birth returns again. In the third age, an age of prophecy, the world and time themselves hang in the balance. What was, what will be, and what is yet may fall under the shadow. So that's a pretty cool tagline for Wheel of Time, this Apparently, this series started in 1990, written by Robert Jordan, finished by Brandon Sanderson when Robert Jordan, I think, died in, let's say, 2009, 2010, around there. So yeah, it's got, let me see, from the Wikipedia, Robert Jordan died in 2007, apparently. The series draws on numerous elements from both European and Asian mythology, most notably the cyclical nature of time found in Buddhism and Hinduism, the metaphysical concepts of balance and duality, and a respect for the nature found in Taoism. Additionally, its creation story has similarities to the Abrahamic religions. Creator or light and the shaitan, the dark one. Shaitan is an Arabic word that in Islamic context is used as a name for the devil or Satan. It was also partially inspired by Leo Tolstoy's War and Peace. So yeah, massive cast, massive characters, massive world. Getting to the point now, we're in the fifth book. The main character, Ran, what's the guy's first guy's name? Ran.
R-A-N.
Well, no, it's got that apostrophe thing going on. Have you ever dabbled in the Wheel of Time? Dabbled.
Yes, I have.
Yep.
Well, only a small dabble. I started to, and then I got hooked on R.A. Salvatore books.
Yeah.
Dritz series, such like that. They're still going on, man. So I mean, they've carried me quite a ways. and also Game of Thrones. So
yeah,
it was a brief dabble. I always thought I would go back to it. Never have. Yeah. But now that there's actually the show coming out, I might get around to it.
Yeah, it's coming out very soon. They have Rosamund Pike as Moraine. Domondrin, you have Randall Thor. Oh, Randall Thor. Okay. So I was listening to the audiobook, and every time the guy says Randall Thor, I always think it's Randall Thor, but it's Ran, R-A-N-D. His last name is Al Thor. Aha. Ah, now we're getting somewhere.
Aha.
You have a character's name, Eugwen Alvary, Lan Mandragonor. Mandragonin, Tom Marilyn, he's like the bard character. You have Perrin Abera, he's a wolf and shapeshifter guy. Matt Cawthorn is basically Rand's best buddy, his bestie. Naive Almadri is a magic user. So they're at the point in the books now, in book five, where Rand, he's the chosen one. He's that guy. He has all the power. He's the Luke Skywalker. He's the Frodo. He's all those people, but he doesn't want it. He's also got the Jon Snow thing. He's got the Jon Snow, I don't want it thing. So, Moraine and the Aes Sedai, which are basically the, you know, the secret cabal, the, what do you call it? Matriarchal society of women who are, you know, trying to control and mold the events of the world to their whim. You know what I mean? They're trying to control basically everything. But Rand is a rebel. He won't be controlled. You know, he's fighting back against them. And they're always saying, they're always telling him the right thing to do. And now he's realizing that they are basically, they have him on this leash. And he's like, nuh-uh. Not going to do that, even though it's the right thing to do. Fuck you. I have all this power. I can do whatever I want. I can summon swords from my hand from nothing. I can, you know, I could cast lightning. I can, you know, make a boulder, fling a boulder 10 miles. Fuck you. I'm all powerful. I'm not going to do what you tell me, even though that's, you know, he's probably going to get himself killed doing that. Yeah, so... I'm about 9 hours left. I'm on nine hours left in the fifth book. So I'm gonna take a break. I'm gonna take a break from that for a while. I think I've listened to. They have a biography of Anthony de Bourdain. I'm probably gonna listen to that pretty soon. And then the end of this month, November 30th, they have the final book in the. Let me look it up here. What is the book called? Leviathan Falls, the final book in the Expanse book series. This is the ninth book in the Expanse book series. The final one, the final chapter in that series. So that's coming out later this month, so I'm highly looking forward to that.
Excellent.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, a break in between books like that is a good idea.
Yes.
You don't
yes.
think about it at the time, and you definitely weren't like expecting it. Like, you hear this a lot with the Game of Thrones, like people saying how George Martin's going to die before he finishes the series.
Yeah.
So, in Robert Jordan's case, he actually did do that. But good, yep. before that happened, I mean, he was pumping out books maybe every 2 years, 2-3 years.
Yeah.
So you do have this built-in break when we were from 1990 to now, or yeah. The end of the series. A handful of years back, but yeah, I mean,
14.
You had that break built in where it's like, all right, I read book one. All right, I got to wait 2 years for the book two. You have basically all of them at your disposal right
yeah,
now.
Yeah.
And there's no fucking way that you'd be able to bang out that entire series and not come out just completely fried.
Yeah.
You got to mix it up.
Yeah, absolutely. Let me see. He must have written a bunch of them like before he released them, because the first two came out the same year. The third one came out October 91. And then, yeah, every year, 92, 93, 94, 96, 98, 2000, 2003. So, yeah, there's like a two-year gap in between them. Then he dies in 2007. Next one comes out in 09, 2010. And the last one came out in 2013. I have heard, and the thing that is, you know, keeping me going throughout the series is that it has one of the best endings in all of, you know, all of the quote-unquote
fantasy.
Yeah, quote-unquote modern-day contemporary fantasy series has one of the best endings of all of them. So
interesting.
That's what's got me going.
Yeah, I mean, like you said, he definitely, like, no writer is completely linear with everything they write. Like, he definitely has had shit written down. I mean, that's how Sanderson was able to come in and pick up, you know, I mean, he could read the series and everything, but he definitely had works that weren't obviously published yet. They weren't even close to being finished, but you know, it's kind of like a puzzle. You piece it all together. Having written things like I'll write something to a point, and then it's just like, all right, I'm kind of at a roadblock here. So, and then I'm like, well, I know where this character wants to go. I'm going to write something more fun, you know? So I'll get to that, and then I'll continue the story from that point, and then I still got to go back and fill in the blank there. So yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah. So I'm looking forward to that.
With putting those books out at the same time, it's not really that. It's just that he has tons of materials. He just has to piece it all together. Or Brandon Sanderson had to piece it all together.
Yeah, I can't imagine doing that.
Or whoever like the publisher is or whatever. It's just like, fuck, dude.
Yeah.
You going to organize this for me? I'll put chapters.
Yeah. So we can end it there, or you want to hear my thoughts on the new Dave Chappelle special?
You want to save that for Andy?
He's never coming on. Come on, man. Come on, man. Come on.
All right, man. Yeah, go ahead. Hit me with it.
Dave Chappelle's new special on Netflix called The Closer was released a couple months ago. I didn't like it.
Got some shit for it, right?
Got a lot of shit for it. This is like a trilogy of these that he's put out recently. I think he had a deal with Netflix to put out like 3 or 4 over the course of the last couple of years. And I believe this is the last one he had, because he mentioned at the beginning that he's going to step away for a little bit after this, since this is like must be the last special he had contracted for with Netflix. But so he has this is like a personal vendetta of his, I guess. It's very much him just clapping back at people that were criticizing him over his last specials, and that's never funny. You know, it's just comedy has to be funny, first of all, to be good comedy. And just having him be so having a chip on his shoulder and presenting himself as that and presenting the material as that is not great, so, first of all. So it's just he keeps talking about, and the trans community is upset at him for some of the jokes he was making. And so basically the entire special is just him talking about how he's not transphobic and how people are attacking him on the streets and accosting him on the streets. And he had one bit about how people, he's like, this woman or this man comes up to me and I can see her cheekbones. And so she came at me and I had to punch her in the face. So that happened. But that was just the entire joke. joke of like, he came at me and I had to give him the old left and right, blah, blah, blah. And that's not funny. You just got into a fight with a person. That's not great. Let me see. So I have a bunch of notes. He literally says the new gays are too sensitive. He does a bit about how the old gays, the Stonewall gays were, a Stonewall was a place where they had a massive police what do you call that? Riot, a police riot broke out and they assaulted a bunch of people and killed a bunch of people in the 1960s and 70s down in New York City. So he invoked that of saying like, these guys were actually, you know, out there fighting for their rights and these new gays are just too sensitive. So first of all, you say anybody's too sensitive these days, right off the bat, I'm just going to say like, no, that's not, people aren't too sensitive. People have been sensitive forever. You know, so saying anybody's too sensitive about anything now is just not true. He draws false equivalencies over and over and over again of saying like, you know, he said specifically at one point, you know, I'm jealous of the gays and the trans community because he's saying like their struggle has been easier for them than it was for the black community. And it's just not, there's no reason to draw those comparisons. They both are ongoing. They're both very difficult struggles over the past, you know, 100 years. And it's just not helpful or productive or progressive to say, you know, our struggle is worse than theirs. It's not a competition. Nobody should be comparing each other's struggles to each other. It's just everyone should be sort of supporting each other. He doesn't know what punching down means. Punching down basically is if you have any sort of power, whether it's political power or it's money power or it's social power, if you are making fun of somebody else or making jokes about another community that has less power than you, which the gay community does and the trans community especially does, they have less power than him, less of a voice than him. He should not be making jokes about them, period, end of story. He's not trans. He shouldn't be making jokes about them because he doesn't understand. He literally says, I don't know what punching down is. If you're a comedian and you've been in this business for 30 years and you don't understand what the phrase punching down is, fucking walk away for a while and come back when you understand what punching down is. If somebody like me who's never been living in that world and I know what punching down is versus punching up would be, you know, fucking Trump, fucking, you know, politicians, talking about CEOs, talking about people in actual power, that's punching up. If I'm saying this fuck homeless people, that's punching down. If punching down is making jokes or, you know, using people but beneath you to make jokes about. That's what punching down is. And if I can say that in one sentence and understand it, then he should be able to very well. You know, he has all these people around him that he can talk to and listen to and understand what punching down is. He should be able to. Like I said, he says the trans community hasn't had it as bad as black communities. He shouldn't be making those comparisons. Trans people aren't just trying to catch him. They aren't just trying to do a gotcha. He has the ability to sit down and think about what he's going to say before he goes on Twitter, before he makes these specials. He can craft these jokes and these things, you know, in a way that people aren't just catching him. You know, I understand if you're out there working a set out that you just started and somebody is filming you, people shouldn't be doing that. If you're a comedian and you're just trying out new material, people shouldn't be filming that and putting it on Twitter because that material is very raw, it's very new, and you're not ready to put it out into the world yet. So that's, in that way, you know, it's wrong to catch somebody like that. But if you're just in a comedy special and you've been working this material out for a long time, think about it more, you know. What else did he say? He said something about, again, it's just these like old hacky jokes where he's like, you know, I have to be looking out whenever I do my specials now or do a stand-up show anywhere. I have to be looking out for people with Adam's apples and big knuckles. It's just like that's such an old hacky joke. You're just saying like, oh, I have to look out for men that look like women or women that look like men. That's not clever. That's not funny. That's just old boomer humor. Very, very out of touch. Just because some trans people don't like his material doesn't mean it's okay. He propped up this woman that killed herself, this trans woman that killed herself. And he says, he mentioned her because she was a friend of his. just because one person likes the material you're doing doesn't mean it's okay. Just because you have a black friend doesn't mean you can make racist jokes. Just because you married a black person doesn't mean you can make black jokes. Just because one person of that race or that ethnicity or that sexual orientation thinks you're funny doesn't mean the jokes are okay. That's just one person's opinion. If the rest of the community doesn't like what you're doing, then you need to stop. That's it. Period. End of story. So, no, it's just not great. He's just so out of touch. And there's people his age, and there's people, you know, other comedians like Bill Burr. Bill Burr is really good about recognizing what's funny and what isn't, what he should be talking about and how to talk about it. Bill Burr is a really great example of somebody of Dave Chappelle's generation that has it. He understands how to joke about, you know, contemporary issues. And again, it's not even fucking contemporary. Trans people and gay people have been around for fucking decades. I hate this argument of like, well, now it's this thing. Now it's trans people and now it's gay people. Really? Because I'm pretty sure John Waters, the very prominent gay man, was making movies back in the 70s and 80s. Nothing is fucking new. This conversation has been going on for decades. We've been having conversations about race and queerness and politics and all of this stuff for fucking decades. There is nothing new about gay people asking for equal rights. There is nothing new about any of this shit. And it pisses me the fuck off that people keep bringing it up like now people are too sensitive about this. Now people are too sensitive about that. And also people saying they're canceling me. You can't say this. You can't say that. There's a guy named Bruce, something Bruce. He literally got arrested in the 60s for making jokes. If you're being arrested for making jokes, that is a direct First Amendment violation. Nobody in decades has been arrested for saying anything. You know, when people talk about people being canceled and how the right likes to talk about the left canceling people, go back fucking 20 years and look at how people reacted to the Dixie Chicks talking about the Iraq War. People were buying their CDs and boycotting their CDs and crushing their CDs heavy machinery. The right has no right. Yep. Nobody has any right to talk about anybody else canceling anybody. You know, that was canceling. That was fucking ridiculous. But anyways. Right. That is the end of my soapbox. That's all I got to say about that.
Yeah, I mean, I didn't watch the Chappelle thing, and I don't think I've watched the specials before that. Say that he's doing any of this for anything other than a paycheck at this point. I mean, didn't he have like some kind of dispute about money, like Comedy Central? I don't know, something like that. Dude's looking to get paid now. He's being lazy, and that's the thing with where. It might be tough for comedians at this point. Well, I mean, to evolve from the humor that made him successful in the past to try to make it nowadays. Like you said, you mentioned Bill Burr, but honestly, he feels like an exception at times. It's just people aren't sensitive, we'll say. I mean, honestly, maybe people are – this is the appropriate reaction, I'd say. Like before, like you look back even as like 2000s or something like that, like just the stuff that you got away with that you don't say these days. It's not even that like, oh, this person's being sensitive. It's because that voice was being suppressed at the time, you know, just bury it down. Like they didn't have a platform to say stuff like, you know, what you're saying nowadays, if he's being serious about it, which I mean, it sounds like the way that you took it and everything.
Yeah.
But, like, it's just that's your insecurities. Those are your insecurities
coming up. Exactly. You're absolutely correct.
And you know, it's unfortunate, but like, I mean, what do you expect? He's an old comedian looking for a paycheck, and he's just like, what do you think is the easiest avenue to take? Like, I used to be funny for these reasons. Well, I guess where I go from here is I can't be funny for those reasons anymore. Pay me, you know?
Yeah.
I don't know. It seems like the next logical step for Dave Chappelle. So, but yeah, I mean, those were very succinct points.
Thanks. Yeah. Just, you know,
too bad Andy wasn't here to hear it. I like that you went and watched it though. Cause Andy, he did hit you with cause originally you're just like, you were saying, oh, I know what makes you laugh and, I'm not going to watch it, you know, based on that. And I thought he did have a good point. I'm like, if you're going to talk about it, maybe you should watch it. And I think, you, in particular, who watches so much media, when I didn't think you really had anything to lose. And I think you came out better for it going and watching it.
Yeah.
So you can put the gloves on and be like, all right, let's do this the right way. All right. Yeah. So it's like men.
Yeah.
So kudos to you, bud.
Thanks. Yeah. Yeah. Alrighty, so we're exactly an hour and a half, 90 minutes. So that is what we call a podcast. So for...
Blazinga.
It's a podcast. So for episode 124 of Can I Say Something, I have been Damien.
I've been Deej.
See you in 2 weeks. Bye-bye.